بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. حديث 610. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت: كنت أطيب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لإحرامه قبل أن يحرمه ولحله قبل أن يطوف بالبيت. From Aisha, she says that I used to put perfume on the Prophet just before his ihram and just before his complete exiting of the ihram before he would make the tawaf al-ifadah. متفق عليه. We have known before that the muhrim does not put on the perfume. However, he is allowed to put on perfume on his body before his ihram, as Aisha did here. And we find from the authentic narration in the Sahihain, she says that she could see the color of the perfume on the hair parting of the Prophet. So this was not perfume on the clothing. So one might say that when you enter the ihram, obviously this perfume will still be on the head or on your body. So will this not invalidate the ihram? We say no, it won't, because you did not put the perfume on when you were in a state of ihram. Rather, you did it before, but the effects of the perfume continue on. So that's the difference. It's a similar thing with marriage. We know that when you are a muhrim, you are not allowed to get married. Neither are you allowed to give anyone in marriage. But if you had divorced your wife in a revocable divorce, then during the ihram, you are allowed to take back your wife. Provided, of course, it's one of the first two divorces. So here this is allowed because it is not a new marriage contract, rather it is a continuation of your previous marriage contract which took place before the ihram. So there's a difference between the continuation and the initiation. The continuation of the perfume or the marriage contract is permissible in the ihram, but the initiation of these two is not permissible. During the ihram, is the muhrim allowed to smell the perfume? Not put it on, but just smell it. Maybe he's in a perfume shop, for example. If he smells the perfume accidentally, there is no problem with this. If he's smelling a perfume to test whether it is a good smell or a bad smell, then what appears to be the stronger opinion is that this is permissible. If he smells the perfume to enjoy the smell, then there's a difference of opinion. Some say it is not haram and some say it is haram. And we would have to say it is far better for you to avoid doing this, because there is something of a opposition to the rule that you're not allowed to wear the perfume during the ihram. Although if somebody did smell a perfume just to enjoy the smell, we would not be too strict on him. What about using perfumed soap? This is permissible because it does not hold true that you are putting on perfume. Rather, what you're doing is that you're washing your hands. And the smell comes onto your hand in following you washing your hand. And it is a well-known rule in the Sharia that ruling which is not affirmed independently can be affirmed if it is in following another ruling. So the fragrance comes onto your hand, but you did not intend to put on this fragrance. Rather, you intended to wash your hand. And washing your hand is permissible. And because the fragrance is in following or underneath the umbrella of washing your hand, it also therefore becomes permissible. In the same way, you're not allowed to sell a baby animal which has not been born yet, so it is still in the tummy of the mother. This is because it is unknown how this baby animal will come out like. But if you were to sell the mother of the animal which is pregnant, then selling the mother is permissible. Let's say selling a pregnant she-camel. This is permissible. But in so doing, you would also be selling the baby which is in the belly. But because the baby is in following with the mother, this trade becomes halal. But if you were to sell the baby independently, then this trade would be haram. Why is putting on perfume not allowed in the ihram? Because we know that putting on the perfume could sometime stir the sexual desire. And this could lead to having intercourse in the ihram. And having intercourse in the ihram is the worst type of haram activity which you can do. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ. There should be no rafath, which is intercourse, nor any fusuq, which is evil, sinful activities, nor any argumentation in the hajj. Are you allowed to spray the air freshener in your tent? The answer is yes, even though this is a fragrance, but it does not hold true that you are putting on the perfume. So we don't need to be overly strict with these rulings, as you often find people doing. Some people may say it is also to remove yourself from indulging in luxury. This may or may not be correct. It can be argued against though, because you're not forbidden from eating luxurious food and drink. And also they may say because you don't want to be enjoying too much in this world, and you want to be focusing on performing the rituals. Aisha says that she would put the perfume on the Prophet before he made the tawaf. This is talking about the tawaf al-ifadah. And she says this would be before he became halal from the ihram. This idea of becoming halal from the ihram is in two stages, the first stage and the second stage. On the day of Nahr, on the 10th, the Prophet began with pelting the Jamratul Aqaba, then he performed the sacrifice of his hadi, then he shaved his head, then he performed the Tawaful Ifada. He did not perform the Sa'i because he had already done that after the Tawaful Qudum earlier on. So you don't need to repeat the Sa'i. So the point is that after the Tawaful Ifada, you become completely removed from the Ihram. So everything which was haram upon you in the state of Ihram now is halal, including having intercourse with your wife. However, before that, there is a first exiting stage in which everything becomes halal for you except your wife. And we'll speak more about that later. But the point is, when is this first exiting of the Ihram? This narration is telling us that it is after you pelt the Jamratul Aqaba and you shave the head. So these two things. Because the Prophet performed the Tawaf al-Ifada after he pelted the Jamra and shaved his head. So it proves that before this, meaning these two activities, he was not fully halal from the Ihram. So the point is that after the first exiting of the Ihram, you are allowed to put on the perfume and you can wear whatever clothes you want to as well. As for sacrificing the animal, this does not have any effect on you exiting the Ihram, except we can say that the one who brings along the sacrificial animal, he should not shave his head until he sacrifices the animal, as directed in the Qur'an. But we'll speak more about exiting the Ihram later on. We can also take from this that it is from good marital relations that the woman serves the husband in these little affairs, like putting on the perfume. And we can take it is recommended to put the perfume on before you make the Tawaf al-Ifada. And especially at the Ifada, there will be a huge group of people. And it's a good idea to have a fresh smell, just like with Yawm al-Jumu'ah. And Allah Jalla wa'ala says, يَا بَنِي آدَمَ خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ O children of Adam, take your adornments to every masjid. You can also take that the Tawaf al-Ifada is from the Hajj. In fact, we know it is from the Arkan of the Hajj, from the Rukun. So you have no Hajj if you don't perform the Tawaf al-Ifada. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, ثُمَّ لْيَقْضُوا تَفَثَهُمْ وَلْيُوفُوا نُذُورَهُمْ وَلْيَطَّوَّفُوا بِالْبَيْتِ الْعَتِيقُ Then let them complete their rites and fulfill their vows and make tawaf around the ancient house. Hadith 611 وَعَنْ عُثْمَانِ بْنِ عَفَّانِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالْ لَا يَنْكِحُ الْمُحْرِمُ وَلَا يُنْكَحُ وَلَا يَخْطُبْ رواه مسلم. From Uthman ibn Affan, the Prophet said that the Muhrim does not marry, nor is he given in marriage, nor does the Muhrim propose to a woman for marriage. Muslim reported it. So with this hadith we learn another item which is forbidden for the Muhrim, which is marriage and even proposing the marriage. So the ruling on this is that it is haram. And if a marriage contract was to happen in a state of ihram, then this contract would be batil, so its presence would be like its absence. And the man and the woman would not be deemed to be husband and wife in the Sharia. And they would be immediately separated, without any divorce needing to be pronounced. The muhrim is not even allowed to conduct the marriage contract between two different people, man and a woman, who are not in a state of ihram. And this contract would not be valid. As for the narration of Ibn Abbas, who says that the Prophet married Maymuna when in a state of ihram, then this is wrong and a mistake from Ibn Abbas. Rather, Maymuna herself says that the Prophet did not marry her when he was in a state of ihram, rather he was outside the ihram. And even if he was inside the ihram, we could say that this is specific to the Prophet. And the reason why this is haram is because proposing the marriage and entering into a marriage contract leads to having intercourse during the ihram, and this is haram of course. We said before that it is permissible for a husband to take back his wife after a divorce during the ihram, because this is not an initiation of the contract, it is a continuation. If a person is in a state of ihram, is he allowed to witness a marriage contract between people who are not in a state of ihram? The answer is that this wouldn't have an effect on the contract, so the contract itself would be permissible and valid, but we say it is better to avoid this. Note here that if a muhrim enters into a contract or if he proposes for marriage, then there is no fidya to be paid. We say it is simply haram and there's nothing more to it. And linked on to this is another type of haram activity, which is having intercourse, but not just that, also passionately touching your wife during the ihram. This is also not permissible. So let us talk about intercourse first of all. If a muhrim has intercourse with his wife before the first exiting of the ihram, and the first exiting happens when you pelt the jamrah and you shave the head. So if he has intercourse before this, and by intercourse we mean that the tip of his private part must enter in either the front passage or the back passage of the woman. Of course, we know entering upon the back passage is haram in any case, but if he was to do this in the ihram, then this carries the same ruling as having normal intercourse. So note here, it matters not whether he ejaculated or not. The only thing which counts is whether the tip of his private part disappeared inside the entrance. So if this happens before the first tahallul, then his hajj becomes corrupt, and he will have to repeat it by way of obligation the next year. However, he must still go on to complete this present hajj. And in the second hajj the next year, he has to offer a fidya, a camel which has to be sacrificed. So in summary, we say, if he has intercourse before the first tahallul, let's say he has intercourse on the night where he's staying in Muzdalifah, then number one, he is sinful. Number two, his hajj is completely corrupted and not counted in his favor. Number three, he has to carry on performing the rituals of this present hajj. Number four, the next year he has to make up for this hajj. And number five, when he's making up for the hajj, he has to slaughter a camel. So these are five consequences. However, these five consequences can only result if he had intercourse, fulfilling three conditions. He was alim, meaning he had knowledge, so he knew the ruling that it is not permissible to have intercourse. He was dhakir, so he did not forget. Because if he has intercourse forgetfully, then there is nothing upon this. And he was mukhtar, so he was not forced. So if he was forced, or if the woman was forced to have intercourse, then the hajj is correct and you simply continue on performing it as you would normally do so, and you would not need to repeat it. It has been narrated from Umar and Abu Huraira that they were asked about a man who has intercourse in his ihram, and they said that he must continue performing this hajj, and the next year he has to make up for this hajj which he has spoilt and offer a sacrifice. So you can see the consequences of performing this action are the severest out of them all, and this is the worst of the forbidden actions in the ihram. The Zahiriya say, if he has intercourse before the first tahallul, then he does not need to continue on with the hajj. Because if the hajj has become corrupt, then how can you order him to do something which is corrupted? Some other scholars from the Tabi'een, they say that if this happens, then he does not continue with the hajj, rather he changes this hajj into an umrah and he becomes halal, and then the following year he has to redo this hajj. So they give this the same ruling as the one who missed standing at Arafah. So if somebody misses standing at Arafah, even a part of the night, then he can no longer continue with the hajj. It's obviously impossible without Arafah. Therefore they say you change it into an umrah and you complete it and become halal. But we say that it is safest to follow the opinion of the sahaba, because they were most knowledgeable in this, even if this does appear to be their own ijtihad, as found in the Muwatta of Al-Imam Malik. And then secondly, if we have this harsh punishment, then it will serve as a deterrent for people having intercourse during the ihram, and it will make the people much more careful about their actions. So what happens if he has intercourse with his wife after the first tahallul? So after he pelts the jamrah on the 10th and he shaves his head, but he has not performed the tawaf al-ifada nor the sa'i, if he needs to perform the sa'i. So this is the first exiting. If he has intercourse before the tawaf al-ifada, then his ihram becomes fasid or corrupted, and he needs to exit the haram and enter upon the area of the hill, which is outside the haram, and he renews his ihram, and he wears the clothing of the ihram as well, just as if he is beginning his hajj all anew. Then he enters back into the haram and he performs the tawaf al-ifada in his new ihram, and upon him is to sacrifice a sheep for performing this haram action. But he does not need to redo this hajj the following year. So note the difference between having intercourse before the first tahallul and after the first at-tahallul. Another type of haram action during the ihram is passionately touching the wife, skin-to-skin contact. This could lead to having intercourse, but just touching her is haram in and of itself. As for merely touching the wife, for example holding her hand when performing the tawaf so they don't split up, then this is permissible. It is a touch with desire which is haram. So during the ihram, if he touches his wife passionately and he ejaculates, then from the ulama are those who say that his hajj is not corrupted, But he has to pay the fidya, which is to sacrifice a sheep for doing something which is haram, and he is sinful. But he does not need to repeat the Hajj the following year. Others say if he ejaculates before the first tahallul, then he offers a camel as a sacrifice, and they make the analogy between this and sexual intercourse. But this analogy is not correct, because ejaculating is not the same as sexual intercourse. Intercourse is far worse than just mere ejaculation. Hadith 612. وعن أبي قتادة الأنصاري رضي الله عنه في قصة صيده الحمار الوحشي وهو غير محرم قال فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لأصحابه وكانوا محرمين هل منكم أحد أمره أو أشار إليه بشيء قالوا لا قال فكلوا ما بقي من لحمه متفق عليه. From Abu Qatada al-Ansari, in the story where he hunted down a zebra and he was not in a state of ihram, the companions asked the Prophet, and the companions were in a state of ihram, and the Prophet asked them, did any one of you, meaning those companions in the state of ihram, indicate to him to hunt the animal or ordered him to do so? They said no. So then the Prophet said, then eat what remains from the meat. Muttafaqun alayh. Hadith 613. وعن الصعب بن جثامة الليثي رضي الله عنه أنه أهدى لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حمارا وحشيا وهو بالأبواء أو بودان فرده عليه وقال إنا لم نرده عليك إلا أنا حرم. متفق عليه. From الصعب بن جثامة, he gave the Prophet some zebra meat which he hunted, and he gave him this present in Al-Abwa, and this is the name of a valley between Mecca and Al-Madinah. Or the place was Waddan, and this is another place. Both Abwa and Waddan are about 240 kilometers away from Mecca. So the Prophet returned this gift to him, and he told him that we are only returning this gift back to you because we are in a state of ihram. Muttafaqun alayh. So these two narrations are talking about another prohibition in the state of ihram, which is to hunt game animals. These are wild land animals who are allowed to be eaten, as opposed to those animals who are not allowed to be eaten, like a lion. So for example, a zebra is a game animal. It is allowed to be eaten, it lives in the wild, and it is a land animal, as opposed to an animal of the sea. Because even in a state of ihram, you are allowed to hunt animals of the sea, so you're allowed to fish. Allah Jalla wa'ala says in the Qur'an, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْتُلُوا الصَّيْدَ وَأَنْتُمْ حُرُمْ. O you believe, do not kill the game animal when you are in a state of ihram. So these game animals fulfill the three criteria. They are wild in nature, or they live in the wild. They are land animals, and they are permissible to be eaten. So for example, a pigeon is not allowed to be hunted. Not only are you not allowed to hunt during the state of ihram, you're not allowed to help somebody else hunt it for you. So if you want to hunt a game animal, but you are in a state of ihram, so you cannot do this, you cannot take a little trickery or take a little device and ask somebody who is halal to hunt it for you. So by giving him a weapon, or by telling him where the animal is, or by helping him in some way. If this happens, you are not allowed to eat the meat of the hunted animal, because you are trying to make halal what the Sharia has made haram. Hunting game animals would be a pastime of the Arab, and they would do it much. And so if this was allowed during the ihram, it was feared that this would occupy them from performing and focusing on the rituals of the Hajj. Hajj is meant to be a time where you dedicate yourself to the worship of Allah Jalla wa'ala, and you leave behind those things which would normally be permissible for you. If a person catches a game animal, let's say a rabbit, before entering the state of ihram, then we tell him that when you enter the state of ihram, you have to let go of this rabbit, because you're not allowed to have possession of the game animal when you're in a state of ihram. If this rabbit now dies under your possession and you're in a state of ihram, then the ulama say you have to pay the fidya. And we'll speak more about this later, but the fidya for the game animal is that you have to sacrifice a similar animal to the game animal you killed from the Bahimatul An'am. Because the point is that this animal died in your possession and you had no right to this animal. It's a bit like if you usurp some property and this property is damaged, definitely you are a guarantor for this property. So it's a similar case here. You are allowed to kill domesticated animals who are not wild by nature, like the Bahimatul An'am or the chicken. Even if, let's say, the chicken is running away and acting in a wild manner, you are still allowed to sacrifice this chicken in a state of ihram, because it is not wild by nature. Likewise, you're allowed to hunt animals of the sea, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَحِلَّ لَكُمْ صَيْدُ الْبَحْرِ وَطَعَامُهُ مَتَاعًا لَكُمْ وَلِلسَّيَّارَةِ وَحُرِّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ صَيْدُ الْبَرِّ مَا دُمْتُمْ حُرُمًا. Made halal for you is the game animal of the sea, and its ta'am, meaning its food, which is interpreted to mean its dead animal, are a provision for you and for the travelers. And the game animal of the land are haram for you if you are in a state of ihram. So notice here, he said the land animals are haram for you if you're in a state of ihram. He does not talk about the sea animals. So the sea animals remain on the general ruling, which is that they are halal for you, and their dead meat, meaning the dead fish, is halal for you to eat. Ibn Abbas interpreted the word ta'am, meaning food, to mean the dead animals. Likewise, you don't have to offer a fidya if you were to kill an animal which you're not allowed to eat, for example a cat, because this does not come under the heading of the game animals. The game animal is something which you are allowed to eat. Remember the three conditions. Another scenario where you don't need to offer the fidya is that if one of these game animals, which you're not allowed to hunt, if this attacks you and you defend yourself and in so doing you kill it, then there is no fidya upon you. Because here you are forced to kill this game animal. And if you're forced to perform a haram action, then it is not haram. So let's recap these exceptions. Number one, if the game animal attacks you. Number two, game animal of the sea. Number three, those animals which you're not allowed to eat. And number four, those animals of the land which are not wild by nature, such as the chicken or the sheep. So with these four exceptions, if you were to kill these types of animals, you do not have to pay the fidya. If a person in a state of ihram hunts the land animal, then this animal is not allowed to be eaten, and it carries the same status as a dead animal, and nobody is allowed to eat it. If a muhrim is in a state of desperation and he's about to die, and the only way to live is to hunt this game animal of the land, and he does so, then is he allowed to eat it? The answer is yes, and everyone else is allowed to eat it as well. Because at that particular time, this game animal was not haram to be hunted. Do we say in this case he is only allowed to eat the minimum possible to survive, or can he eat to his fill? We say he can eat to his fill, because the animal is halal, and it would be just like slaughtering any other halal animal. And it is not the same as eating pork or eating dead meat, because these types of meat are haram in and of themselves. If we go back to these two narrations of the chapter, it appears we have a contradiction, because in the first narration of Abu Qatada, the Prophet is telling the companions who are in a state of ihram that they are allowed to eat from this meat which has been hunted. But in the second narration of Sa'ab ibn Jathama, the Prophet does not eat from the hunted meat when he is in a state of ihram. So how do we make sense of this? Some people say the narration of Abu Qatada took place in the year of Al-Hudaybiyah when they were performing the Umrah. As for As-Sa'ab ibn Jathama, this took place in the Hajjatul Wada' in the 10th year. Therefore, we have a case of abrogation. So this is how they explain it. So they say the ruling is, if you're in a state of ihram, you are not allowed to eat from the hunted animal. But we say this is the wrong opinion because we are able to combine between the two evidences. Some scholars like Abu Hanifa, they say it is halal for the muhrim to eat from the game animal which has been hunted, even if somebody else hunts it for the muhrim. And they take the evidence as the narration of Abu Qatada. They say that Abu Qatada hunted this zebra for the other companions who were in a state of ihram, and the Prophet acknowledged this. Other scholars hold a completely opposing opinion. They say it is absolutely haram for a person in ihram to eat from the hunted game animal, whether this animal is hunted for the muhrim or not for the muhrim. And they take the evidence from the narration of As-Sa'ab ibn Jathama. But the majority of the scholars, and this appears to be the correct opinion, they say if a non-muhrim hunts a game animal for a muhrim, then this muhrim is not allowed to eat from it. And so this is why the Prophet returned the gift to As-Sa'ab. But as for if a non-muhrim hunts the game animal of the land, but not for another muhrim, then this muhrim is allowed to eat from this land animal, on the condition that the muhrim did not help the non-muhrim in hunting the animal, or perhaps indicate to the non-muhrim where the animal is. And so you find with this opinion, both of these evidences are combined together. And this is the best opinion therefore. Because whenever you can work with all of the evidences, this is the route we take. From the narration of Abu Qatada, we can take that it is permissible to cross the miqat and not to be in a state of ihram, because this is what Abu Qatada did, whereas the other companions entered into the state of ihram from the miqat. We can also take from the narration of Abu Qatada that the Mufti needs to ask for further clarification if he requires it. So this is why he asked, "Was there any one of you who ordered Abu Qatada to hunt or indicated to him to hunt the zebra?" Also, the narration proves to us that the means take on the same ruling as the end. Because here the end is that you're not allowed to hunt the game animal, but you could still do this without actually hunting, because you could indicate to a person who is not in the state of ihram to hunt for you, or you could order him to hunt for you. So this is you trying to take a little stratagem to get around what is haram. Now let us go on to talking about the fidya of hunting the land animal. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in ayah 95 of Surah Al-Ma'idah, after prohibiting hunting the game animal, He says, وَمَنْ قَتَلَهُ مِنْكُمْ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاءٌ مِثْلُ مَا قَتَلَ مِنَ النَّعْمِ يَحْكُمُ بِهِ ذَوَى عَدْلٍ مِنْكُمْ هَدْيًا بَالِغَ الْكَعْبَةِ أَوْ كَفَّارَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينَ أَوْ عَدْلُ ذَلِكَ صِيَامًا لِيَذُوقَ وَبَالَ أَمْرِهِ عَفَى اللَّهُ عَمَّا سَلَفَ وَمَنْ عَادَ فَيَنْتَقِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْهُ وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ ذُو انْتِقَامٍ. And whoever from you kills the land animal intentionally, then the price he has to pay is to sacrifice a similar animal from the Bahimat al-An'am as judged by two just people amongst you. And this offering is to be done in the haram. Or the second option is, he must feed an equivalent amount of poor people. Or the third option, he must fast an equivalent amount of days, that he may taste the evil consequences of his action. Allah has forgiven what is in the past, but whoever commits it again, then Allah will take revenge, and Allah is the Almighty and the One who is able to take revenge. The companions have decided which type of Bahimatul An'am is to be sacrificed for certain types of land animals which are hunted. If you hunt a stag, or a wild goat, or a mountain goat, then you have to sacrifice a cow. If you hunt an ostrich, you have to sacrifice a camel, because a camel most resembles an ostrich. If you hunt a hyena, and a hyena, by the way, is permissible to be eaten, which many people may find strange, but we do have evidence for this. But anyway, if you hunt a hyena, you have to sacrifice a ram. For a gazelle, you have to sacrifice a goat. For a rabbit, you have to sacrifice a young she-goat. For a jerboa, you have to sacrifice a she-goat as well. For a pigeon, you have to sacrifice a sheep. For a sand lizard, and this is also halal to be eaten by the way, you have to sacrifice a young male billy goat. If you have hunted anything other than these animals which we have mentioned, then you would need two just people who are experts in this field of animals to decide which of the Bahimatul An'am you have to sacrifice as the penalty, just as the ayah of the Quran says. If for the animal which you've hunted, there is no similar animal from the Bahimatul An'am, then in this case, you would have to pay for the price of the animal which you have hunted, however much that may be. Hadith 614. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خمس من الدواب كلهن فواسق يقتلن في الحل والحرم العقرب والحدأة والغراب والفأرة والكلب العقور. متفق عليه. From Aisha, she says that the Prophet says, there are five animals which are harmful and they can be killed in the hill or the haram. And these are the scorpion, the kite, which is a type of bird of prey, the crow, the mouse or the rat, and the biting dog. This is the dog which attacks you. Muttafaqun alayh. The haram which he talks about here is the haram of Makkah. With regards to killing animals, they are of three types. The type which we are ordered to kill, whether you're inside the haram sanctuary or outside, and these are these five types of animals. And all animals not of this type, but they are similar in terms of the harms which they do. The second category, that which we are ordered not to kill. And this comes in the hadith as an ant, the bee, the hudhud, which is a type of bird, and the surad, which is a butcher bird. It is well known with its crooked beak. So these are not allowed to be killed unless they are harming you. For example, if a colony of ants invade your house and they are eating from the food and they cause destruction, then you're allowed to spray them with an ant killer. But otherwise, you are not allowed to kill them. Then the third category, that which the Sharia remains quiet over. Some scholars say that you are allowed to kill them because everything is permissible except for that which you have evidence. And other scholars say, no, you're not allowed to kill them because there is no benefit in this, and you will be killing a creation of Allah without due right. But we recommend it is better to leave it alone because there is no benefit in killing such animals. So we can take from this hadith that you are allowed to kill those animals who are harmful, or that which will cause annoyance. For example, certain types of insects like cockroaches, or other animals like snakes and wolves and lions, or mosquitoes, because these are harmful creatures. Of course, when it comes to the wild animals, if they are not attacking you and they are just in the wild, then you should not kill them. But it is only when they attack you that you're allowed to kill them to save your life. The majority of the scholars make an analogy from this hadith and they say that any animal which will harm you or will attack you or is harmful by nature, then you are allowed to kill them. And some scholars say, no, it is only these five you're allowed to kill and nothing else. The majority says that these five animals given in this hadith are by way of example. And if they are by way of example, then of course you can make an analogy. So the scorpion is harmful because it stings. So we can include in this a mosquito, because this does the same thing. In fact, mosquitoes can spread malaria, as is well known. As for the mouse, its harms are plain enough. It eats food and it can rip clothing, and it bores holes in walls, and it does many, many silly little things. So it is an annoyance and it can be killed straight away. As for the crow and the kite, these are two types of birds, they would snatch things away, and crows would also harm the camels. So because of this, the Prophet allowed crows to be killed. As for the biting dog, then this is clear enough, it attacks human beings. So if, for example, we have a lion who is wandering around in the streets of a city, then this is allowed to be killed. Nowadays, if this was to happen, people may use a tranquilizer, and this is permissible. What we can take from the mafhum, or the flip side of this hadith, is that if a dog is not attacking you, then you are not allowed to kill it. Some scholars take from this hadith that if there is any person who deserves a had punishment, then this can be given to him in the haram, regardless of whether he commits the crime inside the haram or he commits it outside the haram, and then he comes into the haram seeking protection. And they make this analogy that if you're allowed to kill these animals who are harmful and they deserve to be killed, then you're also allowed to kill a person who should be killed with a had punishment. For example, the adulterer or the murderer. But we cannot make this analogy, meaning the harmful animal with the human being, especially when we know that whoever enters the haram is safe and that blood should not be spilled in the haram. Yes, it's true, if he commits a crime inside the haram, then he himself has violated the sanctuary of the haram, therefore the had punishment can be meted out to him inside the haram. But if he commits a crime outside the haram, and then he comes inside the haram seeking protection, then we say that the haram does protect him, but the people need to treat him so as to force him outside the haram, and the punishment can be established on him. So what the issue revolves around is, did this person committing the crime violate the sanctuary of the haram or not? We can also take from this hadith that these five animals which I mentioned are not allowed to be eaten. So you're not allowed to sacrifice them using a halal sacrifice and then eat them. And all animals which are ordered to be killed are not allowed to be eaten. Because how can you sacrifice an animal and eat it when you are in the very first place ordered to kill it? In the same way, we can say that all those animals which we are ordered not to kill are also haram to eat, because these animals have a hurma or a sanctity about them as well. So with regards to killing animals in the haram or in your ihram, we can divide it into four categories. Number one, those animals who are harmful by nature. So these animals, like the five mentioned here, can be killed in the hil or the haram, or even if you're in your ihram as well, and you don't have to give a fidya. Number two, those animals which are not halal to be eaten, but neither are they harmful. For example, a cat. Then these types of animals should not be killed, neither in the haram, nor if you're in the state of ihram. But if you do kill it, then there is no fidya for you to pay. Number three, the domesticated animals, which are allowed to be slaughtered. And so this would include the behemotul an'am, or a chicken, or a horse. And these are allowed to be slaughtered, whether you're in the haram, or whether you are in the ihram, and there is no sin upon you. Number four, game animals of the land which are wild by nature. So these are the animals which you hunt, and we gave plenty of examples previously, such as the gazelle. Then the ruling on this is that in the haram, these are haram to be hunted, because this is a sacred area, and it does not matter whether you're in the hajj or not. As long as these animals are in the haram, you are not allowed to hunt them all year round. And you're also not allowed to hunt them when you're in the ihram. So now it doesn't matter whether you're in the haram or not. As long as you're in your ihram, you are not allowed to hunt these types of animals. And if you were to do so, then you are sinful and you have to pay the fidya. But do notice the difference here between haram and the ihram. The haram is a specified area. As for the ihram, it is a state which you are in, and we defined it before. So you could be in a state of ihram, but yet be outside the haram. Hadith 615. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم احتجم وهو محرم متفق عليه. From Ibn Abbas, he says that the Prophet had hijama done to him whilst he was in a state of ihram. متفق عليه. The Prophet had hijama done on his head, which would necessarily mean that you have to shave off some part of the head. So we can take from this that it is permissible to have hijama done during the ihram, and there's no problem with this, and we have an ijma' on this issue. And also just taking blood out of your body, maybe through a syringe, is also therefore permissible. And we can take that if you shave a part of your head for the hijama to be done, then there is no fidya upon you, because here in this narration the Prophet did not pay a fidya. So it shows us that if you shave some part of the head off, then there is no fidya for you. It is only when you shave off the whole of the head when you have to pay the fidya. So based upon this, if somebody was to cut short some part of his head during the ihram, then we say, yes, this is haram, but you don't have to pay the fidya. So not the difference. Cutting off some part of the hair is haram, but no fidya. But shaving the whole of the head whilst in a state of ihram, this incurs the fidya. And the hadith for this is coming up. Hadith 616. وَعَنْ كَعَبِ بْنِ عُجْرَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالْ حُمِلْتُ إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَالْقَمْلُ يَتَنَاثَلُ عَلَىٰ وَجْهِ فَقَالْ مَا كُنْتُ أَرَى الْوَجْعَ بَلَغَ بِكَ مَا أَرَى أَتَجِدُ شَاتًا قُلْتُ لَا قَالَ فَصُمْ ثَلَاثَةَ أَيَّامٍ أَوْ أَطْعِمْ سِتَّةَ مَسَاكِينَ لِكُلِّ مِسْكِينٍ نِصْفُ صَاعٍ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. From Ka'ab ibn Ujra, he says, I was carried to the Prophet and lice were falling down my face. And the Prophet said, I did not know the pain has reached you to this level. Do you find a sheep which you can sacrifice? I said, no. Then the Prophet said, then fast 3 days, or feed 6 poor people half a sa' each. Muttafaqun alayh. So we take from this that it is permissible for a muhrim to shave his head to remove a harm, just as Ka'ab ibn Ujra had to do here. However, this does not waive off the fidya which he has to pay, and this is given in the hadith. And we can take that it is not permissible to shave your head whilst in the state of ihram, and it is haram and you will have to pay the fidya. This hadith implies that you should sacrifice a sheep, and if you cannot, then you fast 3 days or feed 6 poor people half a sa' each. But this goes against what we find in the Quran, because the Quran gives a choice out of the three. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 196, he says, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ بِهِ أَذًى مِنْ رَأْسِهِ فَفِدْيَةٌ مِنْ صِيَامٍ أَوْ صَدَقَةٍ أَوْ نُسُكٍ. And whoever from you is ill, or he has some harm on his head, then he has to pay a fidya, or a ransom, of fasting, or a sadaqah, which is a charity, or the nusuk, which is to sacrifice the animal. So it gives a plain choice out of the three. It does not give any priority. But this hadith seems to be giving priority to sacrificing the sheep first. And if you cannot do this, then the other two choices are available to you. However, in another wording of this hadith in Al-Bukhari, we find that the Prophet gives him a choice of the three. He tells him to shave the head and fast 3 days, or feed 6 poor people, or sacrifice a sheep. So he does not give it in the priority format. And so we say that if you were to shave your head off due to an injury or some harm which forces you to shave your head, then you have a choice of one of these three actions. One sa' is 4 amdad, that's the plural of a mud, and one mud is approximately what you can hold in 2 cupped hands. What is apparent from this hadith is that half a sa' of any food stuff can be given, any food which is measured using the kail, of course. But the Hanabila say that yes, you can give half a sa' of any food stuff measured using the kail, except when it comes to wheat, then you can give one mud of wheat, so half of a half a sa', because they say that the wheat is worth more than other food items. Abu Hanifa says that it is half a sa' of good quality wheat, and when it comes to other food items, you have to give one sa', because the wheat is worth more than the other food items. So they take it completely opposite. But we say the hadith is general, and so it should be taken on its generality. So half a sa' of any food item. If you have to shave off your head, then can you pay the kafara before shaving, or do you have to pay the kafara after shaving? The answer is, you have a choice. Much like when you break an oath, so if you take an oath and you find something better, then either you can pay the kafara for the oath and then break the oath, or you can break the oath and then after pay the kafara. So it's a similar case here, where you would have a choice. What you cannot do, however, is to pay the kafara for shaving the head before you enter the state of ihram. Because it is the ihram which is causing you to pay the kafara. And you cannot pay the kafara before the cause. You must do it after the cause. So the kafara can only be paid after you enter the state of ihram. Similarly, with the breaking of an oath, you cannot pay the kafara for breaking the oath before you take the oath. It needs to be after you take the oath. But you can pay the kafara before you break the oath. So notice the difference. You're not allowed to pay the kafara before the cause of the kafara, but you are allowed to pay the kafara before the time of obligation of paying the kafara. And these two examples which we have given about the oath and the ihram are two parallel examples to illustrate this point. What about the fasting? Does this have to be 3 days in a row? The answer is no. It could be any 3 days. And this is because in the evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah, it does not tell us that we have to do it in a row. So we are not allowed to stipulate this condition. But somebody may say that when it comes to the kafara for breaking the oath, and one of the options is that you fast 3 days, is it not true that you have to fast 3 consecutive days? Even though the Quran does not make this explicitly clear. We say yes, it doesn't. However, in the wording of the Mus'haf of Ibn Mas'ud, it says you have to fast 3 consecutive days. So the word mutatabi'ah is included in his version. So we take the wording from his version, and all of the 7 different recitals are revelations from Allah Jalla wa'ala, and they are not the word of man, so we can take from them. And the Prophet said authentically, مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَنْ يَقْرَأَ الْقُرْآنَ غَضًّا كَمَا أُنْزِلَ فَلْيَقْرَأْ بِقِرَاءَةِ إِبْنْ أُمِّ عَبْدٍ. Whoever wants to recite the Qur'an just as it was revealed, meaning freshly revealed, then let him recite the recitation of Ibn Umm Abd, who is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. The other argument could be that because the fasting of breaking the oath is 3 days in a row, so this is muqayyad, it is restricted to 3 days in a row, and as for the fasting of shaving the head, this is 3 days, could we not carry the mutlaq on the muqayyad, as is well known in usul al-fiqh? So we say that the fasting of the shaving of the head should also be 3 days in a row, just like breaking the oath. And also just like the fasting the 2 consecutive months for the zihar, and also for having intercourse during the daytime of Ramadan. And also the 2 consecutive months fasting for accidental killing. So we find that all of these are consecutive fasting. So this could be a counter-argument, where you carry the mutlaq on the muqayyad. So based upon this, it would be safer and better to fast it in a row, because then at least this will be quicker at you discharging your obligation, and that's always the best option. So in summary, what are the haram actions when you're in a state of ihram? The scholars mention 9. Number 1, shaving off the head. Number 2, clipping the nails, and they derive this rule by way of analogy from shaving the head. Number 3, covering the head, and we spoke about the 6 categories. Number 4, wearing clothing which is stitched to fit around the body. And we spoke about this before, and we said that this expression is not valid, and this includes the woman not wearing the gloves nor the niqab. Number 5, putting on perfume, either on the body or the clothing. Number 6, killing the land game animals. Number 7, conducting or entering a marriage contract and also proposing. Number 8, sexual intercourse. And number 9, passionately touching your wife. Let us end the track with a few review questions. So question number 1. Recall the 9 prohibited actions when in a state of ihram. Question number 2. Explain the detail of what must be done if a man commits sexual intercourse with his wife during the ihram. Talk about the first hal and the second hal. Question number 3. Give the detail about the muhrim eating from the game animal. When is it halal and when is it haram?